I'm going to talk about OpenTSDB. We use it at Gute Frage for gathering all of our metrics. First, a quick introduction. I'm Oliver Hankeln. I'm a senior engineer in the data and infrastructure team at Gute Frage in Munich. I was doing development before and switched to the ops side, but I was, since the beginning, even before this term was coined, I was DevOps advocate. I really like tearing down silos. Okay, this is an international conference, so some of you may not know Gute Frage Net. We are actually Germany's biggest question and answer platform, a bit like Quora. People come to us seeking advice and other users giving advice. We are the number one German site for German advertisement ranking with 5 million unique users in the mobile segment, and number three with 17 million unique users per month in desktop segment. Over 4 million page impressions per day, so we have something to measure. Gute Frage Net is part of the Holzbrinck Group. Holzbrinck is a very big German publisher. They are doing e-learning too, but most newspapers and traditional books and some internet sites, websites. At Gute Frage Net, we run several platforms. Gute Frage Net is not only the name giver, but also the by far the biggest platform, but we also have Helpster, that is editorial content, people writing tutorials about how to decorate for Halloween or whatever. Cosmic, which was Lycos IQ a long time ago. Comprano, which is giving shopping advice, and some other smaller platforms. And you see, we are not only growing in every platform, but we are growing horizontally too. We are starting new platforms all the time. Okay, what will you get from this talk? I will explain why we chose OpenTSDB over all the other alternatives out there. Then I think it might be time to introduce OpenTSDB and talk a bit about how OpenTSDB actually stores its data. This wouldn't be a best practices talk if I wouldn't talk about our experiences and would give you some advice. Okay, why did we choose OpenTSDB? About 2 years from ago, we were looking for a new metric system. We hadn't really a good central system for all of our metrics, and we were looking at some options. They are quite well represented here. First of all, we wanted to scale. We are now at 4 million page impressions per day. We want to measure really everything so that we get really deep insight into our application. We do not only want to measure the traditional ops metrics like load and disk space utilization, but we also monitor business data like AdSense income and application metrics like how much Google users like the answer and how much dislike it. So we really gather a lot of data, and so we wanted something that scales very well. Moonin obviously doesn't. It's plain simple. It's for if you have a dozen servers, it may be okay, but not for us. That was very clear from the beginning. Graphite is better. We've heard from Immobilien Scout, they use it, but they too see a limit to the scalability when it comes to communication in the cluster in this case. So yes, you can scale it, but there are limits, and we try to avoid these limits. OpenTSDB does scale. You have it's built for clustering, for clustered running, and it's not an afterthought like with Graphite. Ganglia 2 does scale quite well. Then we said we want to keep all data. We don't want compaction like with RRD, because we do not only have the load graph, and perhaps we don't need the load graph anymore, but really we wouldn't even want to throw away the load graphs. We are living in a big data world now. And the biggest lesson, I think, of big data is that you don't know what your data will be worth sometime in the future. You don't know what you can do. If you ever threw away your web server logs, you might be regretting it now when you see what you can do with this data once you have the mechanisms in place. So we don't want to throw data away because we think we could could use machine learning in the future to see trends and to detect anomalies. So no throwing away of data. And okay, I mentioned RRD, and Moonin is based on RRD. Graphite uses Whisper, but it's basically the same idea. It's a ring buffer. You throw data away. OpenDB doesn't. It stores its data in a data store and just keeps on storing. If you don't delete it, it will not be deleted. Ganglia, again, uses RRD, so throws data away, unfortunately. Creating metrics should be easy. We were looking into that, too, because we wanted to really create loads of different time series, and we were looking into how hard it is. But really, it's easy all over the place. If you use RRD or Whisper, you have to put a little bit of thought about how long do I want to keep the data, but apart from that, it's easy with all tools. So we still had a winner, OpenTSDB. And we were just looking at these things. We were not looking at alerting, for example, because we believe in a separation of concerns. We come from a Unix world. I know some of you have to deal with Windows servers, and I'm very sad for you, but we come from a Unix world, and there it's traditional to have these pipe monsters, perhaps not exactly this one, but but you do use specialized tools for small tasks and combine them together to get your system how you like it. So alerting is not a concern for us when we chose, it wasn't a concern for us when we chose OpenTSDB. We use Asynka for that. Yes, and as I talked about separation of concerns, so the ecosystem is quite interesting. Our application feeds data into the OpenTSDB via RapidMQ. They just fire whatever they want to track, and we have a consumer that puts everything they do into our OpenTSDB. They don't need to ask our permission if they want to create a new metric. They just start sending this data to the queue, and it's ending up, and they have a graph 5 minutes later. We do alerting, of course. We use Asynka for that, and we grab the metrics, we grab the data from OpenTSDB and have our checks run on that. I said we had the idea of using machine learning in the future. A bit in that direction goes Skyline from Etsy. What they are doing, they establish a baseline for every metric you have. And if you are more than 3 sigma away, they say, hey, something weird is happening there. And it's a nice idea, but if you have data that has a strong seasonality to it, for example, if you start out sending our newsletter in the morning, and that's a big jump, Skyline tends to point that out as a problem, and it isn't really, but I talked to Abe Stanway from Etsy, and he's looking into more sophisticated algorithms to tackle that in the future. And they also develop Oculus, that in the case of there's an anomaly that Skyline detected for you, it says, and by the way, there are 5 other metrics that correlate to it. And so you get a better view of how your system as a whole works. Very nice, but very early stages, but definitely worth keeping an eye on it. We deploy all of our sensors with Chef, so that when we start a app machine or run a new whatever load balancer, the according collectors for the metrics are in place too. Okay, I talked about we use it and where we use it, but what is it? It stands for Open Time Series Database, and it just does that, stores time series. And it was written by at StumbleUpon, is open source. You can just grab it from GitHub. It's storing all of its data in HBase. And HBase itself is based on HDFS. I will talk about that later. It's a distributed system. You run multiple time series daemons, how much you like. And when one of them dies, it's not a problem at all. Just start a new one or use the old ones, the remaining ones, no problem at all. It basically looks like that. You have HBase there. This is not a machine, this is a cluster. If you're using less than 6 machines, don't bother with it. It's for clustering, and it's distributing things about at least 3 machines, so you are supposed to have a cluster. There are some how many you like TSDs, and the user interface, the API connected. It's a simple telnet protocol or HTTP. At the moment, you can't send in data by HTTP, you only get it out, but that will change in the future. And T-Collector is one of the ways to get data in and uses the telnet protocol. Putting data into OpenTSDB is very simple. Telnet to it, the standard port is 4242, probably because it's the answer to something or so. And then you just put your metric name, a timestamp, metric value. Values can be integers and floats. They are stored with 8 bytes. And you can have, you need to have at least one, but you can have an arbitrary number of tags, like in this case, host is something, and then you can filter afterwards to get only the load for your host. Or if you do clusters, we do also clusters like clusters app machines or clusters DB machines, then we get a load graph, an accumulated load graph of all the DB servers. But it's not actually that hard to put data in because T-Collector comes to the rescue. It's a Python script that is bundled with OpenTSDB. OpenTSDB itself is written in Java, but this is a small Python script, and it handles for you the network connection. It starts your collectors. You just put them in subdirectories. There are subdirectories with numbers. So if you have a subdirectory 30, it starts your collector every 30 seconds. If you have one with one, it starts your collector with every second. And there's one special directory, zero, is for long-running collectors that should run all the time and sporadically output some data. It does process management. So when a collector hangs, obviously not a collector that runs indefinitely, but all the other collectors, when they hang for more than the interval, they are killed and restarted. And if you have a long-running collector, if it dies, it is just restarted. It automatically adds the host tag. You don't have to do that. And it does the duplication. A lot of people are afraid of, should I really check my hard disk health every second? Yes, you should. And it's not a problem because T-Collector says, okay, and sends it once in every 10 minutes. And the rest of the time, if nothing changes, it doesn't send it out. But once it changes, you have it on second precision. So a simple T-Collector script looks like that. I'm just casting a die there, putting it out to standard out. T-Collector will grab that, add the host tag, fire it over to the OpenTSDB, and really you're done, and I think my daughter could do that. Okay, this is not, I'm sorry for mentioning big data again, this is not a big data conference, so some of you may not know HDFS. It's a distributed file system, Hadoop file system, and it's suitable for petabytes of data on thousands of machines. Facebook has a 12 point something petabyte cluster on 1,100 machines, so scaling is not a problem here. It's a bit like with Google. Google has their Google file system, and it's written inspired by that. It runs on standard hardware. You don't have to have any special servers or whatever. And yes, just cheap off the shelf servers. It takes care of redundancy itself. So if you write something in, it only comes back and says it's written when it's been written to 3 by default different machines. So you have strong consistency. And the redundancy obviously is configurable. By default, it's 3 machines need to have it. It's used by a lot of the big names: Facebook, Spotify, eBay. Google has their own system, but the idea is the same over there. Okay, that's HDFS. On top of HDFS comes HBase. HBase is no SQL database, no SQL in the sense that it's not a relational database. You don't have SQL as a normal language to access it. And you have arbitrary number of columns in your tables. don't need to have to be the same for each rows. It's really data store. It's putting its file on HDFS. It's modeled after Google's Bigtable. Again, Google has had the idea. That's the free implementation. And it's built for name Bigtable says it, but it's really literally billions of rows and millions of columns. And they even say in the documentation, if you have 1 or 2 million rows, that's not the tool for you. If you have some hundred millions of rows, then look into that. It does automatically shard your data across regions and uses the row key. You only use the row key for selecting your data, and it's sharding it across different machines using that. Okay, how does it store its data? I said they shard by the row key, so you should put some thought into the row key. And you query by row key, so you have to know not exactly not the exact row key that you're looking for, but you have to say it starts with A, W, whatever. You can have ranges. So you can say, give me everything from A to D, no matter how the key goes on after the A or the D. That's fine, but you can't select by column value. You have to have a basic knowledge about the key. So it's really important that you think about key design if you're using HBase. First try would be, let's use a timestamp because we want to select by timestamps. We have ranges and put the metric ID behind that. Works well. You put that's a timestamp. You would omit the comma, of course. You put a you have binary row keys. They don't have to be humanly readable. So you have a timestamp. It's metric 5, and we store the value of 17. Same second metric 6. We store 24, and so on. Everything goes to server A, because he is the region server for that. Until you get to the boundary of the region. Then the rest goes to server B. The problem, I think, is obvious. You have some time where all of your metrics are going to one server. And once that server reaches its limits, you can't add new metrics anymore because the server just can't handle the load. So the solution to this is swap. Put the metric in front, and after that, use the timestamp. And that does only work because you don't track one metric or two metrics, but hundreds of metrics, so that it will be sharded out over your cluster, and you avoid having hotspots. So in that case, when the boundary is between 5 and 6, that would be the distribution, and you are having more than two servers and more than two regions, so it gets spread out very nicely. Okay, so the second idea is metric ID first, then timestamp. That works, but you have a lot of rows, because you're putting hundreds of millions of data points per day in, probably. And searching to a lot of rows is much slower than searching to through fewer rows, obviously. So we start, okay, we put multiple data points into one row. I said we have the ability in HBase to have millions of of columns in one row. Let's use that. It looks like that. You have now timestamps. You see it's oddly a round number because it's only one row per hour. That's the timestamp of the start of the hour. The column names, that's the row key, the column names or cell names are the offset to that. You say, okay, this hour plus 23 seconds. And there you store the value of 17 or 1, whatever. So you have, for each metric, you have one row per hour. And it's much faster to search through that. Yes?
Does the metric key include the host name, or is it just the metric ID is system load? Or is it host A or system load like
that? Excuse me, please, sir. Can you repeat the question?
The question is basically what happens with the tags.
If, and
yes, exactly. And yes, very good question. And we put them at the end of the row key. We can't put it in front, because then we would move around where the timestamp starts, and you don't you are not able anymore to have a selection of a range. So we put it in the back. And we put not only in the metric the tag name, because every metric has probably host, so it wouldn't help us in selecting. We also put the value there, and they both are stored as IDs. So the row key really consists of 3 bytes metric ID, then 4 bytes of the timestamp rounded down to the last full hour, 3 bytes for tag ID, and 3 bytes for tag value ID, so for your host name or cluster name or whatever. And you can have as many tags and tag values as you like. So you see, whenever you have a new tag value combination, you start a new row too. So might be a good idea to keep that in mind. I'd like to show you some graphs now. I hope the Wi-Fi is working. Yeah, looks great. Or not. But I'll try anyway. Yeah. Exactly. That's our email rate. These are live graphs. We have annotations. You see when the last deployment was. They should be doing one today. That we release once or twice a day for the main application. The services are released after every commit. But the main application is only released once or twice a day. We are in the morning, you can subscribe to I'm an Expert for monitoring. And whenever monitoring questions come in our system, you'll get an email in the morning with all the monitoring questions of yesterday to answer for you. And you see that spike there. And that's exactly a problem for Skyline at the moment, because if you have a baseline about where the usual values are, if you start doing something like that, it just breaks. Okay. The colors are awful. We are monitoring errors, not only PHP errors, which are somewhere there, and MySQL errors, which are there. Yeah, PHP is there. This, I think, green, I'm colorblind, line. And the blue thing here, this is JavaScript errors that we are responsible for. So when a user loads JavaScript from our servers and the JavaScript breaks, we have an error handler there, and it sends a signal, hey, the JavaScript broke, and the error message, and some kind of diagnostic information. The red line is JavaScript we are not responsible for. We are using mainly AdSense for our income and some other advertisement. So really, other guys are putting code on our website, and we can't really do anything about it, but we handle it. And if something like this morning happens, someone will call them and say, hey, take your crappy ad off our website. This is the first half of the metric. Yeah, that's our content production. You see, we have a really strong seasonality here because we are just focusing on the German market. In the night, nothing really happens. In the day, a lot of things happen. And we would like to have a system where we could, with the system that knows how the shape of the traffic and of the content production usually is and tells us anomalies. So I'm really interested in the last talk today in this room. He seems to be doing something like that. Okay, can you see that? Probably not. Okay, that's the variability of the content length during the day. I'll skip that one. This is a release, a deployment in September. You see it at the URL. You can, these graphs are generated by URL, you can just edit there. We had a release, you see, you could perhaps see when we deployed here. And this is, the green line is the median, and medians don't help you at all. We have percentiles, and you see something was happening to some users. It's the 90 and 95% percentile where the response time went up, but nevertheless, we had to fix it, and they fixed it somewhere around here. So we have percentiles, but we have to pre-compute them. That's a bit of a problem because you can only store one value per second. No. Yes?
How ugly is it to create such graphs?
It's really quite simple. You have a URL. You say start time, end time. If you omit the end time, it's up to now. Then you say an average over the last 2 minutes of response time P99. That's the 99% percentile. And add some more. So it's really an URL that you can combine. There's a user interface, but at the moment I wouldn't recommend it. So it's we really added the URL and save it as a bookmark.
And how do you know which metrics are in the system? So is there a browser where you can say, okay, I have this metric?
That's really a problem, because there is an auto suggest feature, but it's broken. In my opinion, just doesn't work. You have to have a naming scheme so that you know what you're putting inside. It's easy to lose track of your metrics if you don't do that. Oh. Yeah, let's go on. Okay, our experiences with the system. We store 200 million data points per day. We have a 9 machine cluster, but we're not using it only for OpenTSDB. We throw all of our log files in there, and a Hive database would be another talk. And it handles the write load really easily. T-Collector works quite well, and it really decouples your collecting from the OpenTSDB. If the connection breaks down during the day, it's even buffers data so that you don't lose it, and when the connection is up again, it just sends them out afterwards. I showed you creating new metrics is really easy, but there are problems. And yes, the user interface is lacking, and it's seriously lacking. The auto-suggest doesn't work, and I really envy graphite users because they have a slick user interface, but again, I was talking about separation of concerns before, and you can get out the data in a machine-readable format, so you can put your own user interface up. You saw these annotations we do for deployments. We also have them for when pingdom calls, but there's no annotation support out of the box. We patched that in. It's still flawed. You can't turn it off, which is not a problem if you look at graphs like that. But if I showed you the graph of the last 2 years, you have a lot of vertical lines and don't see your graph anymore. And we have only 1 second time resolution. That in itself isn't too bad for us. 1 second would be okay, but you can only store one value per second. So you have, if you want to look at percentiles, you have to pre-compute it. And I think that shouldn't be the way to do it because, as I said, we live in a world where you learn afterwards what you want to do with the data and don't know in advance. Salvation is coming, at least for some of these things. OpenTSDB 2 is around the corner. There's a release candidate 1 for about a month now, since about a month now. So they will probably release it very soon. That will give you a millisecond precision. So it's much easier to just put all your requests and the response times in and then figure out the percentiles afterwards. They will have annotations and metadata. At the moment, you don't have any data about what does this metric really mean. You don't have units for the values. You just have numbers. That will come in OpenTSDB 2 and decent annotation support, which is why we don't really fix our annotation patch anymore. The API will be improved. You will be probably able to put in data with HTTP then. So there will be improvements. So some friendly advice, Yes, pick a naming scheme and stick to it. You have to know where you put your metrics and why, how you name them. Use tags wisely. It might be tempting to put everything in tags, but that does not only use 6 bytes per row key, but it also gives you much more rows, and so the seeking time will be much longer. Okay, it's a fast system, but it's decreasing the performance if you use too much tags. So 6 or 7 tags per data point is still okay if you need it, but don't exceed that. Use tcollector if you can. It's really taking the hard stuff, like opening a network connection. Okay, some of you might be able to do that on your own, but use it. It's working and it's nice. And if you're not using OpenTSDB now, you should start looking into it and perhaps using it, but wait a few weeks until OpenTSDB 2 comes out so you don't have migration hell. Now, I forgot the most important slide of all. If you want to try it out, you could also apply for a job at us. We are hiring. Okay. The Isinga talk yesterday was 30 minutes too long. This is 30 minutes too short. You get an early lunch break, but first, your questions, please.
Did you thought about using Graphite first and then store all the stuff as an archive solution in OpenTSDB because you have a slick interface you mentioned?
No, we didn't. Okay. The question was, could we use Graphite for our interface and put the data in there, and from there put it in OpenTSDB for archive purposes? No, we didn't think about that, and I think it's not a really elegant way to do it. Since you have an API to get the data, you can add your own user interface. And I heard rumors that the Graphite interface might be that there might be a connector in the future for OpenTSDB, so we might get that sleek interface. There was a question somewhere in the back. Yeah.
One moment, please. I come to you.
Sorry.
Regarding using OpenTSDB as a replacement, more or less drop-in replacement for something like RRD tool or JRobin, like we've been using with OpenNMS, how are you, or have you thought about the problem of handling things like roll-up, consolidation, normalization, those things that RRD tool and the like give you for free that OpenTSDB doesn't really know about? Do you have any thoughts on that?
I didn't get roll-up compensation.
Like aggregation, normalization.
Okay, you get aggregation. You have it in the URLs. You have, okay. Forget about it. You have some aggregation functions there, and you can get the raw data out and have do whatever you like with that. And we want to feed it into machine learning afterwards. And so we don't think aggregation is really what should be done in our time series place. It should be done in whatever's analyzing the data.
Thank you.
Okay, any more questions? Okay.
Yes. I'm sorry.
Definitely.
Enough time for questions. So I work for Bull, and we have customers who also state, okay, I want to store everything for as long as we could imagine running our data center. And my concern is that you have a lot of data, but you do not know what to do with it. It's just that you would like to say, or not use personally, but I think some of our customers maybe, they would like to say, okay, I have 1 billion rows in my database, and yeah, I have 1 billion rows. And that's only the only thing they would like to state. And they do not know what to do with it. And it seems that you have some idea what to do with it, but basically you are waiting for the future, for the big data, the promising white knight that's coming and say, okay, you have so much data and now you know what to do with it. Is it kind of this that you, or do you know today what to do with all this data?
Okay, there really is a bit of a hope that we might use the data in the future, but the situation has changed. When RRD was modern, disk space was expensive and we hadn't found something like distributed file systems that we have now. So you really had to think about keeping the data in range. But now disk space is basically very cheap. It comes next to nothing. And in the future, you might be able to use it. That's true. And we have some ideas what we could do. And there's also the aspect that we are not using it only for operations metrics. If you say load doesn't interest me in 3 years on a second-by-second precision, that's okay, and it's your decision what you want to keep. You can delete data. But we are using it for quality data to the length of the answers that I wanted to show you. For us, it's an indication of the quality of our content, because if people get pissed off or just drunk, they usually answer that something like, Google it yourself, or don't know, don't bother me. And it's really crap and doesn't help anyone. But if you go and answer a question with a serious approach, you will end up writing a longer text. So we use it to measure whether our actions to improve quality, to reward quality, are actually paying off. And if you have metrics like that, and you have metrics, want to have metrics like how things changing during the day, to for example, to know how much community managers you have to have on duty in the night or whatever, because you know, okay, last time the Olympic Games started, there was a spike, and then you can foresee it for the next time, and if you smooth it out, all of them or that or throw it away, you can't do that anymore. And so if you're not only using it for what's the state of my system now, but also to learn how it evolves, I think you shouldn't throw away data if you can avoid it and it's cheap.
But for this, you need the context as well, right? You maybe go down paranoid and say, okay, I need the current temperature outside because maybe this influences the metrics I have. Because if you have metrics from 10 years ago and you have the software version 0.0.0.5 and you did not know the context of the metrics 10 years ago, then it's not... there's no need for storing the data because you lack the context. So how do you store the context of
We have a bit of the context with the annotations. We see when a version of our software rolled out, and we have the Git version number or SVN version number, depending on which part of the software it is. I'm still using SVN in some places, sorry. So you can go back and look exactly at what version was running back then. That's the one thing, and it really is cheap to have a new metric. And once you have a metric system like that in place, you really stop worrying about, do I really need that? If you think you might need it, put it in. The data gets compacted after it's been written. I omitted that because it doesn't really change how you interacted with it. But it's 2 to 3 bytes per data point. So if you want to track temperature, if you track it second by second, it's 160 kilobytes per day. So what?
Maybe I bother you afterwards, but if you do not have the context, so maybe our chancellor has a bracelet that is very nice and the peak of usage in your system is triggered by external events that you cannot measure the whole world. At least you are not the NSA, so...
You don't know that.
If you do not have this context, then...
Okay.
I don't know...
But you can try.
Yeah, you can try. Yes. If you have an infinite amount of money.
We try to monitor as much as possible for us and as much as sensibly possible for us. We don't track the Chancellor's wardrobe.
Yeah, but maybe you should.
Maybe we should. And if you write a collector, I will happily add it.
And you said it's 3 lines to write a collector, so...
Yes.
You were.
Okay. No. Seriously, you try to monitor as much as you can about your system, and you try to monitor everything yet that you can monitor that might affect it. But it's true, you can't monitor the whole world. That's the direction we are going, but we will never reach it, and it's probably good that we don't.
Okay. Then I think we don't have any questions anymore. So thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you for your time.